We provided input in the lead up to the ministerial conference of the WTO in Bali, where the push that we made was for trade facilitation. So we were successful in obtaining the agreement that we have on trade facilitation, which is currently being ratified. And then as a second round of that, in order to try and move forward other elements of the DDA, ICC, through its World Trade Agenda, put forward some post-Bali business priorities on a multilateral trade and investment policy agenda. So these include ratification of the TFA, arriving at some outcome on the main elements of the DDA, which are agriculture, NAMA and services, expanding trade in IT products and encouraging the growth of e-commerce, liberalizing trade in services, multilateralizing trade liberalization under the WTO framework, especially pulling in the liberalization occurring under RTAs, fostering greener economic activity through trade in environmental goods, and further the promotion and protection of investment worldwide. And last but not least, sustain and strengthening the WTO dispute settlement system. So these were a set of priorities that we put forward way in advance of the ministerial that is going to open this afternoon. And what we did in order to buttress those recommendations is we commissioned a report from the Peterson Institute of International Economics in Washington to try and look at those proposals, to try and put numbers to them, and then to try and see what their perspective as a trade think tank was on adding to those proposals. And so Peterson produced a study for us which was thought to do just that. And we have been promoting this study as an interesting attempt from a sort of academic slash think tank perspective of how to progress the WTO agenda in a very concrete way on a number of concrete items that are within the DDA or outside the DDA. So the purpose of the panel today is to sort of bring ourselves up to speed, I guess, on some of these elements and see what our panel of business experts have in terms of views on these and how we can see these moving into the future. So I simply want to introduce our speakers. I will start with speaker furthest to my left. Peter works for the Danish Confederation of Industry and works on trade policy. So he works on both multilateral and bilateral trade policy, as well as exports controls and Arctic affairs, I read. So he's well-versed to address the issues that are before this panel. Just next to him, Gabriela Ursel is with Philip Morris International. And she is responsible for trade policy and trade instruments, also trade treaties in PMI. And she also covers investment policy. So she covers issues such as market access, barriers to trade, investment protection, and intellectual property. To my left, Michele Pastore is with Samsung Electronics, and he looks at the impact of EU trade policies and customs regulation on the company he works for, and he represents Samsung in a variety of business organizations, including the International Chamber of Commerce. And to my right is Anke Lisa Schild, who is a senior policy advisor for government affairs with Siemens, and she works out of the Siemens EU representation office in Brussels, mainly on trade and foreign economic policies. So we are going to give you a perspective on elements on the multilateral trade and investment policy agenda, and we will start with Gabriela. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Stefano. Good morning. I'm very happy to be here today to exchange views on the future of the multilateral trading system, because I think this is what's at stake today. This is not exactly the title of this panel, but I think this is what's going to be discussed in the next few days here in Nairobi, but particularly also in the next few days, weeks, and months following Nairobi. And from a business perspective, this is really relevant. It's more relevant than it may appear at first sight, because even though it's not going to change our life, in the short term, I think in the midterm, it is going to shape the way we conduct business and the jobs and the economic development that trade brings. So I think it's a very, very relevant topic to discuss. Already a few weeks ago, I would say, it was pretty clear that ministers in Nairobi would not achieve any substantive decision on the core issues, a discussion at least in such a way that would allow us to think, well, the Doha round has been concluded, at least in the way that it was thought 14 years ago. Today, there is no doubt about it. However, I think this is not really such a big problem, and let me tell you why. I tend to think of the WTO as an iceberg. As you know, what we see of an iceberg, the tip is really a tiny little portion of its real mass, because most of its mass lies below the surface of the cold water. But this hidden part is actually the most important one and potentially the most harmful one, because it's the one that, if ignored, can cause a ship to sink, okay? So if we look at the WTO, in my view, the DDA is really the tip of the iceberg. It's a visible part, is the one that still sometimes makes it to the headlines. But everything else is at least equally important. And by everything else, I mean the other legs or the other functions of the WTO, so the monitoring and compliance of the existing rules and regulations and agreements, and also the enforcement of these rules through the dispute settlement. And this is really, really what has to be preserved in addition to the negotiating function too. We know that the Doha round was launched 14 years ago, obviously at the Doha Ministerial Conference, and this was precisely the same ministerial that witnessed the accession of China to the WTO. And if we look at China 14 years ago and we look at China today, the major world exporter, I think there are no doubts about the importance of the WTO in generating economic growth, development, and good governance. And I think pretty much the same could be said in a different scale with, regarding any of the acceded countries. So the WTO is relevant. For the members, it's an institution that gives every single member, big or small, the same rights and opportunities and pretty much the same obligations. So it creates a level playing field. And for us in the private sector, it really represents a safety net that allows us to navigate through this complex net of international trade rules. But as the G20 put it recently, the multilateral trading system is extremely relevant, but its negotiating leg is struggling, at least. So why is it? I mentioned China. When China joined 14 years ago, or acceded WTO, it marked the beginning of a new era, that of the BRICS, the emergence of the BRICS. So when these emerging economies actually started to be more active in world trade, what happened in practice is that it changed the old paradigm of trade-offs that had been at the basis of the Uruguay round and at the basis of the launching of the Doha round. Because the old trade-offs of, I give you market access for your agricultural products, but you give me market access for my industrial goods or my services, lost interest, because these emerging economies actually are very diversified, and so they just cannot accept this old structure that was created to some extent by developed countries back in the 80s. But also there are no other champions, because the traditional developed countries that were actually at the forefront in getting a new wide round, getting a WTO and getting a new round, soon also lost interest. You know, the US, the EU, they started looking immediately at preferential trade agreements because it appears to be an easier solution. So no champions in the form of members. And last but not least, the private sector appears to be at least less active than back in the 90s. So here we are. The energy, everybody's heads are turned into preferential trade agreements. I mentioned this. This seems to be an easier solution because it's obviously easier to reach a deal among 12 countries than among 150 almost, or 60. So is this good? In my view, not necessarily, because we are obviously in a globalized world and an increasingly fragmented set of rules is complicated. From a business perspective, it risks tangling this safety net that the WTO represents. And this is the more so for small and medium businesses than for big companies like mine, but it's really, I guess, applicable to all. The WTO still needs to be the basis, in my view, for the international trading rules, and preferential agreements can build upon, but not reduce the basic principles that the multilateralism represents. So now what? In these coming 4 days, there will probably not be any substantive decision on the core issues, but hopefully the ministers will achieve something that will allow us to say, you know, happy birthday WTO, happy 20th anniversary. Hopefully there will be some package that will address the needs of LDCs. Hopefully, perhaps there will be some disciplines on export subsidies. Maybe there will be an agreement on the ITA too. What's certain is that there will be two accessions. Liberia and Afghanistan will join, and these, together with the recently acceded Kazakhstan, will raise the number of WTO members to 164. So 164 is not a small number. There are no preferential trade agreements that can obviously have such a figure. And the fact that countries continue acceding the WTO, I think it's a proof that it's still relevant. Then, you know, after Nairobi, in the next few months, hopefully WTO members will focus on the implementation of the trade facilitation agreement, hopefully the implementation of the ITA, and maybe also of the environmental goods agreement. And this is something that from the private sector's perspective is extremely relevant and will have very concrete practical implications. Now, in my view, the important thing is not what will happen this week, not what will happen in the next few months, but what will happen in the midterm. And I think in the midterm, all the actors, WTO members, the business community, and the rest of the civil society actually need to pause and think of what is the role that we want for the WTO going forward. In my view, the important thing is that the WTO is not really weakened, because we have to think about, you know, the part of the iceberg that lies below the surface. The important thing is that the WTO plays a role in ensuring that these preferential trade agreements that are a reality actually do not undermine but build upon the principles that the WTO creates and continues building this safety net for all of us. How is that going to happen? I don't know. There are many ideas floating. One is something like a varied geometry that would give countries flexibility to adopt the rules or not, or maybe this a critical mass approach of plurilaterals, or maybe all of the above. But the truth is that we really, really, it's really important to think what role the WTO will have in the future to preserve this level playing field that it creates. And I think it's important, as we learned in Paris a couple of days ago, that icebergs can actually melt. And so we have to be careful that this doesn't happen to the WTO. So just to conclude, very, very quick 3 points. One, I think the WTO plays a pivotal role because it represents a safety net. It creates a level playing field and it gives every single member the same rights and the same opportunities. Second, the key is not what happens here in Nairobi or what happens in the next few weeks, but what will happen with the institution going forward. And I think that it is imperative for all the actors involved in trade negotiations to really think if we want to keep the ship afloat. And if that's the case, I think it's really important not to forget the part of the iceberg that lies below the surface. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gabriela. I will now give the floor to Peter. So we'll go through all of the panelists for introductory remarks, and then we'll open it up to questions from the floor.
Well, thank you. I'll focus on, in my remarks, I'll focus on two elements that are relevant for the WTO discussion. First of all, of course, the trade facilitation agreement, and then on elements looking ahead, I'll focus on one element, that's the element of export controls. Now, this is my second WTO ministerial. I went to Bali for the ninth ministerial. I was sort of a trade policy rookie at that time. So one of the rookie mistakes I made there was to book my ticket home on the Friday evening. I did not make the same mistake this time, although I should probably have reversed it, because as you were saying, Gabriela, it looks like everything will end on Friday, but then we can maybe go on safari on Saturday, so that's maybe a good substitute. Anyhow, the Bali Agreement was obviously a tremendous step forward in terms of trade facilitation. It showed that the WTO is still relevant, and it showed also that that all member states could basically see that we have here an area that is of such tremendous benefit to all of us that it makes sense to make a sort of an early harvest on this area of trade facilitation. Maybe just to go over some of the numbers on trade facilitation might be worthwhile reminding ourselves. It's estimated that it will increase total exports by $1 trillion per year. Most of those will those increases will be in developing countries, around $600 million. 21 million jobs will be created. Again, most of those in the developing countries, around 18 million. On top of those figures comes the sort of more qualitative aspects, of course, quicker, more speedy transshipment of goods across borders, which also means less loss of goods due to rotting vegetables and what have we. And also, of course, less corruption, which I think is an extremely important part of this whole agreement, because with the whole digital solution element of transshipment in trade facilitation, it becomes less easy to be a corrupt official. So that's, of course, a huge benefit to businesses. I think probably not least here in Africa. If you look at the map, you have the port of Mombasa, which is the main sort of hub for container traffic to East Africa. It takes around it's around 1,700 kilometers from here to Kigali in Rwanda. That's a trip which should, including rest for the driver, etc., should take something like 2 days of driving, even on sort of occasionally bad roads. But it's a trip that nowadays takes something like 10 days, because the truck driver has to stop at weighing stations, at police checks, at a couple of border crossings as well. And all of this takes time and it costs money. And probably every time he has to cross some of these crossings, he has to pay a little sort of facilitation payment to move ahead. So it increases the costs of goods, which might also rot on the way to Kigali. So trade facilitation is extremely important, and basically this whole issue is maybe one of the main things that can improve inter-African trade here. Various figures have been floating around between 10 and 13% of Africa's trade is with itself intra-African trade, compared to 60% of trade which from Africa which goes to Europe and the US. And that's obviously too low a number. Africa needs to increase that, and trade facilitation can help to do that. I think, unfortunately, we are not where we should be on trade facilitation. Kenya became the 57th country to implement the agreement or ratify the agreement last week. Still, a great number of countries need to ratify. We need to be at, I think, 108 before the whole agreement comes into place. I believe there's still important players like India missing out on ratifying the trade facilitation agreement, and also a couple a good number of African countries. So efforts need to be stepped up here. I think as businesses, we'd hope that Nairobi would be the place where we could sort of put the seal on the trade facilitation agreement, said that it was now ratified and ready to be implemented. The funds have certainly been made available for it. There was a pledging seminar yesterday by the European Investment Fund, I think it was, who gave a lot of money for LDC countries to implement the trade facilitation agreement. So basically, the framework is ready, and countries now need to pick up here. On export controls, it's true, as Stefano said in his introductory remark, that I also deal with export controls. In my world, export controls is mainly about giving guidance to our member companies on what they can't, or which items, which products they can't export to what countries, why they can't export a piece of artillery to Iran, for instance, or dual use items to India or whatever. And basically, in my world, export controls is about ensuring that critical products that can be used for harmful purposes are not brought into the wrong hands. But for some people, export controls, or for some countries, export controls is also about ensuring that strategic products, mainly raw materials, are not exported out of the country, so as to ensure that the home production base has a steady supply of cheap raw materials. We've seen that in India, where they've limited or restricted the export of industrial minerals, for instance, rare earth. We've seen it in Canada, where they restricted the export of lumber, or actually logs, I think, not lumber, because that's two different things, logs. And we see it in the U.S., where they restrict the export of oil and gas. Now, basically, all of these export restrictions are extremely harmful to global economy and to businesses, because it means that we can't get the raw materials at competitive prices that we need, and it's basically not helping the host country, because it just cushions their companies from outside competition. So I think, looking forward, what we would like to see is that the WTO, and I think this would be a relevant discipline for the WTO to pick up on, is to try and see, can we agree on a common framework to remove or restrict the export controls that countries put in place. For instance, like a code of conduct for how to deal with this issue. I think this should be possible. At least, for instance, the US has shown the way forward on this. I mean, they in general restrict the export of oil and gas to the global community, but with their trading partners, the ones that they have free trade agreements with, they've opened up. So if they opened up towards those trading partners, why not to the rest of the world? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Peter. We will now move to our third speaker, Michele Pastore, who will give us a perspective on things more digital, I guess.
Grazie, Stefano. Yeah, thank you for the non-Italian speakers. I would just like to touch based on the concept of digital trade. For those of you who were yesterday at the plenary, Ambassador Mohammed referred to the future of WTO in 2016 and beyond as focusing on digital trade. Digital trade are the future in the sense, and digital technologies are actually the enablers of many of services and also trading goods that we see today. Just have a question for the audience, maybe. How many of you actually have ever bought stuff on the internet? How many times actually do you do it over a month? It depends. Well, according to some statistics from the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, about 50% of all the services are actually digitally enabled. The OECD countries, I'm not sure for the figures for the entire world, but in the OECD countries, we have a statistic of about 95% of companies relying on the internet for their own business, and about 70% of households actually use the internet, and 30% of them have actually access to e-commerce facilities. So the figures are very important. They're actually keeping on growing. This gives you the perspective of what we are actually talking about. ICT technologies are therefore at the foundation of all these, all businesses and trade as we speak now. How did we reach this stage? Well, if you look at the world back in the 90s, the mid of 90s, around 95, we had about 16 million active internet users. Nowadays, we have something like almost 3 billion active internet users. So this gives you the magnitude of how many people can actually rely on these kind of technologies. This movement, these trends, have surely been enabled by some successful development in technology, but also successful development in trade talks. I'm referring to the ITA. I will touch base on the ITA a little bit later on. I just want to refer now to some other figures. When we refer to digital trade, we not only refer to the technology enabling trade, so internet or all the sort of telecommunication technology, but also we refer to trade in digital goods, such as content, for example. Now, in the ICT sector and in general, in the digital trade community, we talk a lot of cross-border data flow and how important it is to ensure that data content can freely move across the border. Actually, Ambassador Mohammed yesterday touched on this point as well. I'm not sure how many of you are aware that content and digital goods are actually the fast-growing components on trade. Between 2008 and 2012, they grow an average of 49%, whereas if you see the growth in normal goods, let's say intangible goods and services, the growth is around 3%, 2.7, 2.4, something like that. So digital goods are becoming one of very important component of trade, world trade in general. So I was referring to the ITA. The ITA, as all of you know, was one of the landmark deals coming out of the WTO in the 90s. And as we speak, we are now trying to finalize it. I'm saying trying because the deal is not done yet. Our colleagues are actually negotiating not far from here. And as we speak, at this moment, there is not a deal yet. At least these are the latest information. So we hope actually to reach an agreement in the next days. The ITA, the new version of the ITA, will not only refer to finished goods, but also components. Now, for a company like Samsung, having a worldwide supply chain, having easy access to components without paying excessive duties of these components is essential. It's essential because the ICT world is a very competitive world. Technologies are outdated in the span of 6 months or maybe 8 months. You may all see that, you know, when you have a new mobile phone, in the next 6-8 months, there is a new version. So the previous one is outdated. The profit that you make out of these technologies are really low in terms of margins. This is true for smartphones. It's true also for bigger goods like TVs, where I think margins are around, it's really one digit margin. So it makes you understand how competitive this world is. Not only from the company perspective, but also from consumer perspective. One of the big success of the ITA was not that much companies to import goods freely, but making this technology for consumers. As we speak now, nowadays there are new technologies. There are all these sort of hybrid goods. Back in the 90s, there were no such thing as smartphones. All these multifunctional machines, connected TVs, all these sort of internet-enabled devices were not there. This is what we are trying to achieve now with the new ITA. In addition to the components part. The ITA, though, and the ITA talks are not only about tariffs. There is an important component about non-tariff barrier. Now, this is not being negotiated in this current ITA2 negotiation, but there are talks happening, and there will be a new NTB, hopefully, new NTB's negotiation in the future. Already, there has been few discussion in Geneva on that. I just want to refer to 3 points, which I think they are important when we talk to NTBs and what can actually be done in the digital world and the ICT sector when addressing NTBs. One is for sure enhancing transparency on administrative requirements for selling technologies in specific countries. We have now the TBT notification system, which is a wonderful system, and it works perfectly, but it's not enough. Often when importing goods and then placing goods on a specific market, you need to do much more than just technology, that you need to address much more than just technology barriers. There are all sorts of administrative and bureaucratic requirements you need to look at. There are some proposals on having a list, for example, of conformity assessment for electromagnetic compatibility. But it would be interesting and probably a good move to expand this list to all other sorts of administrative and technology requirements. Another possible area that we can look at, and just throwing out there for, you know, sort of food for thought, is harmonizing conformity assessment procedure. Of course, it is, you know, sort of a unicorn. It's not going to happen. But nonetheless, we can look into possibilities of at least bringing this conformity assessment procedure closer and having a discussion about that. Another point, and third point, is about e-labeling. Now, e-labeling for the ICT geek is something really important. Why? Because by enabling e-labeling on all ICT products, which basically means having all the regulatory requirements being shown on a screen and on a label attached to the device itself, you can save, first of all, cost. You can produce more environmentally friendly goods. You can also curb all those design requirements that we have nowadays for ICT products. So these are three elements we might want to look at when it comes to NTBs and ICT products. And I'll be happy to touch maybe later on taking question on the trading data. But now I stop now and I'll give the floor to my colleague Anke for additional information on the data and cross-border data flow.
Thank you very much, Michele. And now I give the floor to Anke, who is going to talk about cross-border data flows, among other things.
Thank you, Stefano, and good morning, everybody. Thanks for being here. So as Stefano mentioned, I work with the company Siemens, And Siemens is generally a well-known company, but not always for the right reasons. Yesterday at the cocktail reception, I was asked if I was selling mobile phones here. That's not the case. So Siemens, we're a global manufacturing company. We employ around 340,000 people worldwide. We have around 300 major manufacturing locations, be it in the US, in China, in South Africa, in Germany. And Siemens products, you find basically along three buzzwords, electrification, automation, and digitalization. What kind of products should you think of? This can range from gas turbines, electric motors, transformers, wind turbines, industrial automation equipment that you use to make your factory more efficient, but also mobility solutions like high-speed trains or metros. And then also we have a big part of our business that is medical devices. So we're a very company with a very wide-ranging offering. So that just as a background. So in my remarks, I would like to touch on two points. The first is the environmental goods agreement, which is being negotiated at the moment. Actually, not at the moment, but it is being negotiated. And secondly, on global data flows. But before I do that, maybe first let me say a few words about why the World Trade Organization and why are we here. So for Siemens, and Gabriele was mentioning this already, there is now, of course, a very big focus on bilateral agreements. You have the big bilaterals, like TTIP, for example, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, but also many other agreements, the EU-Vietnam, other bilateral agreements that are being negotiated or that have recently been concluded. These are very interesting from a company perspective because they bring new market access opportunities, they bring newer rules in the area of trade and investment. At the same time, they also create fragmentation. And if I talk to the customs department at Siemens, and Siemens is a massive enterprise with lots of people who have time to look into customs regulation, but they find it very complicated to deal with this spaghetti ball of bilateral rules. And they always tell me the World Trade Organization and the uniform rules that are set here, there is no alternative for that. So therefore, for Siemens, the World Trade Organization remains the number one priority. At the same time, I have to acknowledge, and it was also mentioned yesterday, the word frustration. If I mention the WTO or specifically the Doha round at Siemens, I don't make myself very popular. Because generally people are just not confident that something will come out even after this long period of negotiation. I don't want to sound overly pessimistic, and I think, for example, Peter mentioned the trade facilitation agreement. That is a really interesting deal with also commercially very interesting opportunities, and it also shows that the WTO as an institution can do something with its negotiating arm. So I don't want to paint a too bleak picture, but there is a skepticism in the business community at large that even though the World Trade Organization is of fundamental importance, there's a sort of a question mark around how the WTO will ensure that this negotiation arm will stay relevant. But I think from the business, there's all the support that it should stay relevant and that it should sort of get its act together and deliver. Now, speaking about deliveries, one of the, from my point of view, very interesting negotiations that's ongoing at the moment is the negotiation around environmental goods. And this is a negotiation that was started a bit more than a year ago by a wide range of countries, but including the US, the European Union, and China. The idea behind this agreement, and it's similar in its structure to the information technology agreement that Michele referred to, is to make trade trade in environmental technologies, products that have a good impact on the environment, to make this trade more affordable. In the first step, by eliminating the customs duties that are levied on these kind of products, but possibly in a second step also by looking at non-tariff barriers. And what kind of products can you think about? Well, this is mainly what the negotiations are about. But for example, things like wind power equipment or waste management systems. But there's a whole range of products. I think the current list they are negotiating is around 200 products. This, from a Siemens point of view, is an extremely interesting, potentially interesting agreement because we produce, of course, a lot of this equipment. We have, for example, very energy efficient motors, which have the potential to have a very beneficial impact on the use of energy that's, for example, used by factories. It's unfortunate that this agreement has not gotten a lot of traction within the broader WTO membership. And I think that is something that you see with more agreements, also with the information technology agreement, that the interest remains limited to a relatively limited group of WTO members. Whereas I think that the issue of making environmental technologies more affordable is something that could interest a very wide range of countries. And there's currently some interest now shown by, for example, Thailand and Vietnam. They are interested in joining the negotiations. And I would recommend other WTO members that haven't done so yet to just take a look at this agreement and see if there's something in it for them as well. Being part of the negotiations, of course, allows you to shape the negotiations. And even though in the end, the results will be on an MFN basis, so everybody will benefit. If you join during the negotiations, as I said, you still manage to shape the outcome. The second thing I wanted to mention, and this is also coming back to a point that Michele mentioned on digitalization, is regarding data flows. And you might think, data flows, why is a company like Siemens which high-speed trains and gas turbines and wind turbines, medical devices, why do they care about data flows? Well, actually, the whole subject of digitalization, it runs as a sort of red line through the whole Siemens business in very simple but interesting ways. So, for example, when we install metros in a city, we don't only deliver the metros and say, well, goodbye, thank you very much, but we also offer a wide range of services around the metro installation. So, for example, we have the systems that allow sort of mobility management, traffic management, so that we can calculate what is the optimal distance for the metros to run from sort of the speed at which they run, the distances which they run from one another. And, of course, we use data to calculate these kind of things. The same holds true for wind turbines. We have wind turbines installed all around the world, and we collect the data from these wind turbines. They're being analyzed in a facility we have in Denmark. And with the data we generate there, we give instructions or advice to the operators of wind parks worldwide on how they can better how they can make the most efficient use of their wind parks. So, for example, in which direction do they turn the blades of the wind? But this kind of advice, this kind of service, we can only provide because we have access to the data, we can analyze the data, and then give that back to the customers in a format that they can use, that they can work with. If we just give them the bulk data, it doesn't mean anything necessarily to them. So this subject of data and data flows is becoming increasingly important, not just for Siemens, but for a very, very wide range of companies. And it's not a discussion, so this is a discussion that's very relevant in the business community, but it's not yet a discussion that I see very much on the WTO's agenda. And I think that's a pity, because some people are saying data is like the raw material of the future. I think that this whole subject of data and data flows, it's here with us for a long time, it's here with us to stay. And I think the WTO can really make a very interesting contribution into seeing how the worldwide market for data flows remains open. Sometimes there's a tendency to see data flow as a risk rather than an opportunity. And I think it's important for the WTO to mix or to bring itself into this discussion, to see whether maybe there can be some guidelines or at least an exchange of views on the importance of data flows globally. To not be part of this discussion means that other actors will have this discussion. And I think it's just a missed opportunity for the World Trade Organization. So I want to leave it at, with these two points at the moment on the Environmental Goods Agreement, which we strongly support and hope that more countries will join, and the subject of global data flows, where we hope that the World Trade Organization will also bring itself into this debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Anke.
So we have a pretty varied menu here of issues, some on the WTO agenda, others not entirely, others in progress. I don't want to summarize what everybody said, but I think Gabriela painted a broad picture of the system, the values for companies and business in the system and what can be achieved through it, both the visible part and the less visible part. Peter touched upon the TFA, which is one of the seminal achievements of the most recent seminal achievements of the system and how that needs to be carried forward in very concrete terms, and also what the WTO could possibly do in the area of export controls. And then we have had a perspective on the importance of digital trade, e-commerce, information communication technologies, both in terms of the goods that enable this trade, but also from the perspective of what regulatory environment is needed to ensure the continued development of digital trade. And cross-border data flows clearly is part of that, but not only, because cross-border data flows is something that traditional companies in completely traditional sectors depend upon to do their business. So it's something that affects business across the board. And last but not least, environmental goods. I think this is a particularly topical issue because of the recent agreement struck in Paris on climate change. This would allow the WTO to show very concretely how trade can be an enabler of measures to combat climate change through greater diffusion of environmentally sound goods, and how that can be facilitated through the global trading system. So we will now open the discussion to questions from the floor. Obviously, what has been raised by panelists is game for questions, but we don't want to restrict it to that, but we don't pretend to be experts on everything either. But anything you might want to ask, please feel free. I think this lady here had her hand up first. Could you please just briefly identify yourself before you ask your question, and then to pick up on the bon mot of a moderator yesterday, make the question shorter than the answer. Thank you.
I'm from the University of Northern Iowa in the U.S. I kind of have two questions that came up. Okay, switch off. First, Peter, you were talking about export controls, and I'm wondering if you are doing anything with the import controls that create the restrictions from the other side. And with the data flow, I happen to be a technology dweeb, okay? What kind of barriers, tariff or non-tariff barriers, are put in place or you're anticipating could be problems with data flow?
Well, obviously import restrictions is equally, if not more, important and crucial than export restrictions. I think the problem is that import restrictions come in very many forms. Some of them are dealt with the trade facilitation agreement, which basically removes barriers to imports. So that's one element. But then you have the whole element of technical barriers to trade, which is essentially also import restrictions. And that is that is something that it is partly possible to deal with in the WTO on the phytosanitary issues, but obviously a very complicated issue and something that's being dealt with at a more advanced level in some of the regional trade agreements. For instance, it's an extremely important component of the ongoing TTIP discussions, but also a controversial element there. An extremely important perspective there.
I should have not said I would be happy to take questions on cross-border data flow. No, I was joking. It's not that we can anticipate. A lot of those barriers are already there. And talking about forced localizations of data. Many countries in the world, not, you know, name, shame, any country, but many countries in the world requires data to be shared locally. and they cannot be moved across the border. They should be stored in the national boundaries. Of course, the other aspect of it is security of data. When we talk about personal data, we have all the data protection requirements applying in different regions of the world. But the main barrier, it really refers to forced localization. Now, for companies, trading in data or using data as their to back their business, this is a big issue because it brings increases in costs. You need to install servers, storage system in different regions of the world. Sometimes you cannot link those systems because restrictive regulations about sharing of data. We are trying to address these issues in different fora. I work in Brussels, and especially when it comes to data protection, this is a very heated debate. The EU and the European citizens, they have a very specific view on protection of data, which is very strict, and rightfully so, for historic reasons. But indeed, this is the main barriers we identify, in that sense. I don't know, Anka, if you want to add something.
No, I think that's also from my point of view, those are the barriers that we see already at the moment. And that is also, I think, the direction in which the debate risks to move even further if we don't explain better what are also the benefits of global data flow. Because very often the risks of global data flow are very predominant in the discussion. And there are very genuine concerns around, for example, data privacy, which Michaela mentioned, which should be taken extremely seriously. But there should be also, of course, a reflection on what are the benefits of this global data flow. And when I referred, for example, to the sort of consultancy advice that we can give on the use of the wind turbines, I think that's a clear benefit where you can point to a win-win for the environment, but also for the operators. And maybe, Stefano, you talked about COP21. I just wanted to pick up on that and say that I was actually in Paris last week to give a speech at the COP21. And one of the great things I got to announce there, which I thought now that I have the occasion and I do it here as well, is that Siemens, as a manufacturing company, I mentioned we support the Environmental Goods Agreement. We were also looking forward to an ambitious climate outcome. But we also reflected ourselves, what can we do and how can we show that we are serious as a company about CO2 emission reductions? So my CEO a few weeks ago announced a commitment that Siemens will be completely carbon neutral by the year 2030, which is relatively quickly. And we do this because we think it's the right thing to do, but also because it makes business sense for us. So one of the things we will do is to invest 100 million now into making the energy that our factories need to make that energy supply more, coming from renewable sources, to make our factories even more efficient. So that 100 million we're investing, but we are at the same time predicting that our energy costs can go down by 20 million a year. So it's not only that this is the right thing, but also because it just makes business sense. And the technologies are out there, and we are a company that can help provide them for other companies, but also city governments and countries who are serious about CO2 reduction. So sometimes the discussion about the emissions discussion is very much about what can we do 20 years from now, but we can do very much today.
Thank you. I don't pretend to be an expert on data flow as Michele or Anka, but I just wanted to share with you one interesting case study that I came across recently in the context of the TPP negotiations. As you know, governments have different public policy objectives to protect public health or animal welfare or security or morals. And one of these objectives, these objectives, if don't addressed properly, may create sometimes barriers to trade. And so in the context of the TPP negotiations, one of the concerns were that some countries had moral reasons to want to restrict the internet content that would come into these countries. And so this is also another example of a barrier to trade that can restrict data flows.
There are discussions right now in New York. I'm sure some of you know at the level of the it's a high level segment of the General Assembly deciding on whether or not to continue with the multi-stakeholder model of internet governance under the IGF, the Internet Governance Forum, and these issues, you know, openness of the internet are very much part of that. So all of these issues are linked. So what we're looking at here from a trade perspective is very much part of a broader set of issues that are being discussed in other intergovernmental organizations. The gentleman here had a question, I believe.
Thank you. I'm Lambert Buerta from South Africa. On the environmental services side, what happens to services? I mean, sure, your company must be heavily involved in environmental services delivery as well. Now, the goods agreement, how do you see this play out? Would services be added later on? Do you see services be somewhere else in TISA or wherever? How do you see that?
We'll just take maybe a couple more questions, and then the panel can deal with them. Lady here, please.
Thank you very much for a very interesting panel. I'm Sherry Stevenson, ICTSD. And I just wanted to ask maybe if what you had discussed today picked up the recommendations in the Peterson Institute report, or if those went beyond what you've discussed on the panel, and if there's something in the report that you haven't covered in the discussion and that you want to highlight, given that it was the ICC that commissioned this report. Thank you.
Maybe one more question, if there are. And okay, well, we'll deal with these then.
Thanks. Thank you for the question. Yeah, environmental service, extremely important subject. We would ideally love these negotiations on the environmental goods agreement to be the environmental goods services investment and procurement agreement. It would be ideal, of course, if a company like ours, we don't just deliver the good, but then everything comes around it. I mean, very often this is part of a tendering process, and we offer installation maintenance services, training for the people who are operating these systems. But at the same time, we have to be realistic. And if you look at the negotiations of the information technology agreement, where for a very long time there has been a discussion about adding non-tariff barriers to the issues to be discussed, it proved extremely difficult to get that on the table. So I think the more pragmatic approach was to say, well, let's start with the environmental goods agreement and see whether, if this is a success, and a short-term success, so not a negotiation that takes 10 or 15 years. And we can perhaps build upon that, but of course this is up for the negotiators, and I'm not at the table. This is up to the negotiators to see whether they can build upon that success and maybe bring in other elements like non-tariff barriers, maybe localization requirements, or specific barriers around services. Possibly there is a link with the TISA agreement. I don't have the final answer to that because it's also not so clear yet whether these issues will be dealt with in TISA. It's an ongoing discussion. So the question is spot on. We would like to see more of these services issues covered. So I hope that's the direction that we're heading in.
Well, let me maybe just add to that, because the environmental goods agreement is something that's extremely important for us, for Danish companies, because it's we have a lot of companies dealing in environmental goods. One of them is a direct competitor to Siemens, but I'm happy to say also located their factories in Denmark. Vestas, which produces wind turbines, just like Siemens Wind Power. And Vestas is nowadays, I think something like 50% of their turnover comes from services. And therefore the services element is of course extremely important to deal with in an environmental goods agreement. That's one element, and Ankan mentioned procurement. I mean, environmental goods are mostly bought by governments, or to a large extent by governments or through government grants. And one of the problems that that environmental goods companies face is local content requirements and strict procurement rules in individual countries. So we need to address this element of procurement in a future, hopefully future EGA agreement. And one last remark on environmental goods. I noticed yesterday in her introductory remark, Amina Mohammed mentioned a lot about the need for Africa to get access to environmental goods. I fully agree with that, of course, and maybe Kenya and other African countries should consider joining the negotiations on an environmental goods agreement, because basically, as Anka said, now is the time to deal with what products should be on the list so that the agreement also becomes as relevant as possible for the developing countries.
Thank you very much. Just to try and answer the question from the lady at front here from ICCSD on whether we covered all the issues in the Peterson report, the answer is no. We've only selected a few that we wanted to highlight in the context of, I guess, what's live in terms of the ministerial conference starting this afternoon. Peterson goes beyond that. Even our post-Bali recommendations go beyond that in terms of coverage. I guess one we could mention that is not covered and not being discussed is the whole issue of investment, but I think that's very central. As we're moving to a more globally integrated economy, as many of the challenges that we're talking about today, financing for development, SDGs, climate change, services, all of these issues are very closely linked to investment. So some kind of a move forwards to more towards a more common framework on investment is definitely something that we see as something that needs to be further discussed.
If I could maybe just make one comment on the investment element, because investment protection is something that's been highly controversial in the last couple of years, not least in the context of the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, or the negotiations between the EU and US on a trade agreement. There are a lot of myths on that discussion. I don't want to go into those, but basically, just say that it maybe highlights the need for investment protection to be moved into the multilateral level once again. I know there's been attempts before, they were not successful, but maybe now is the time to do that.
Yeah, I just wanted to take a step back on the environmental goods agreement. My understanding is that there is a clause to address services, at least in the drafts that they are discussing. But what I want to say is, when discussing TISA, we should always bear in mind that TISA is outside of the framework of the WTO. So it's going to be something different. Maybe we can bring it within the framework of the WTO, but the EGA is born within the WTO, as, for example, the ITA. So there are two different agreements in nature, and this will have also an effect on their implementation. In TISA, for example, the big discussion is bringing China in. There are two schools of thought on that, from two big regions in the world, but things that you don't have in EGA, for example. So it will be a different animal from that perspective.
Are there any other questions from the floor? Yes, please, the gentleman at the back.
Thank you. I'm Jonathan Peel. I'm a member of the European Economic and Social Committee, an official EU advisory body, and one of the voices of industry inside the EU. I wanted to pick up a point made by the, I think it's Peter, I can't pronounce your surname, I'm afraid, and Anka. Anka made two very interesting comments. First of all, she talked about the clear rules of a multilateral agreement against the spaghetti rolls of FTAs. And you also hoped that more countries would join the environmental goods agreement. And Peter said that Kenya and other countries should consider. My question is, how do we make it attractive for other countries to join? Because my concern is, even with plurilateral approach, we'll only cover, what, two-thirds of trading countries? How do we get the other third back into the fold?
Thank you.
Well, how do we make it attractive? I mean, do you want to take part in shaping the future? Then you need to be at the table. And I think that's the message for those standing outside these agreements. I know that the environmental goods agreement might not seem so attractive for some African countries because it will because they don't have that much production of environmental goods as it is today. But still, they will be the ones who will benefit hugely by lowering the costs of environmental goods globally. So, yeah.
Thank you, Jonathan, for the question. I think there's two ways of looking at that. You can look at the offensive sort of export-oriented side, and this is where I come sort of with my technology issues. But I know from other countries in from some of the participants in the EGA negotiations, like New Zealand and Australia, for example, they also are trying to bring on board more land-based products like wood, I believe, and biomass. So it's also up to countries that are participating in these talks to define their offensive interests. And I don't want to presume that I can speak for anybody, but I think so. That's of course then the job of the negotiator to identify what their offensive interests are. But that's the export side, and I want to caution at the same time against focusing only on the export side. I mean, one of the reasons why I think this agreement will also benefit Siemens, and one of the reasons that I'm helping spread the word, is also because it will help Siemens to have cheaper access to inputs. We are paying customs duties on inputs that we are bringing, for example, into Denmark, where we have a facility, but also the US, where we produce our wind turbines. So we are paying import duties on those inputs, and that is making our end product more expensive. So it makes it more costly for us to sell that to our customers. So I think there is, on the one hand, deciding on your offensive export interest, but also recognizing that it's in your interest because you can, in the end, have more affordable access to these technologies that allow you to reduce CO2 emissions or just to have a more beneficial impact on the environment.
I guess most of the time, at least the idea behind these plurilateral agreements is that they will be applied on an MFN basis. So even those who did not negotiate could in theory benefit. And this raises a lot of concerns about free riding, for example. But I think what's really important for every country is to realize that indeed, as Peter said, have a seat at the table is really, really important. And we hear during these days here at this conference that, for example, Africa trades very little within Africa. And so I guess the fact of having the opportunity to sit down with the big trading partners and discuss and put their own priorities on the table is really invaluable. That's at least my view.
Sorry, I don't want to monopolize the answer on this question, but maybe just, and this may be more for Michele to say, but on the information technology agreement, there was Costa Rica as one of the members who you might not immediately associate with a strong interest in IT products, but they partly through participation in the ITA really positioned themselves as a platform, as a hub for IT trade in the region, which was very successful. So I think there is also that element that you put yourself on the map towards global manufacturing companies and other companies as a country that's very serious about a specific sector or a specific business.
No, yes, indeed. The parallelism with the ITA and the example of Costa Rica is fantastic. Costa Rica is one of the most important IT base in Latin America, in Central America, and Latin America in general. I, in parallelism with the EGA,
the main attractive point is the economic benefit. There is not an export benefit in that sense, so not that much as you can have it in companies based in Europe and the US, but it's the access to these enabling technologies that, especially in a time where we are discussing, you know, environmental requirements, so is the next big thing in that sense. So we need to look at the possibility of accessing freely, not freely maybe not, but cheaply these technologies and enable African countries, but I'm not thinking only about Africa, again, South America as well, to benefit from this kind of cheap technology once the fossil fuel are, you know, going to be phased out.
Oh, sorry. Thank you. I was going to sort of ask a question in relevance to the one that was asked just then. My name's Diane Tipping from the Export Council of Australia. Thank you for recognising Australia as being proactive. And I'm also from the International Association of Trade Trainer Organization. What I wanted to just say was Australia, before you mentioned it, is very active in the bilateral and multilateral free trade agreement area. We have our 10th one starting on the 20th with China this week. We are also part of the TPP, and we have two that we hope agreements that will be developed in the next few months with Indonesia and India, and have a lot more on the table that we want to do. We are also very active in the WTO negotiations. Why do you think that works? I mean, I really think the WTO is a level playing field, and as someone mentioned, and we need to continue with all of those agreements, but we also need to do our own. Is there any comment on that, or what are your feelings on that? Please.
Just picking up on the first part of your comment, I do recognize that Australia has a very strong role in the Environmental Goods Agreement. I mean, they're chairing the negotiation. And I think I'm very encouraged by the recent initiatives of Australia to open a lot of these trade agreements. I mean, also the fact that you are now, that your government made a first offer to become part of the government procurement agreement, which, I mean, it is driven by Australia's government to make that unilateral offer, because they see the benefits in the governments in Australia at central level, but also at sub-central level, to have access to the best goods and technology that they can get internationally at a good price. So I think that's a very good development. I'm very encouraged by that. And I'm not sure I have an answer to your question, because maybe I also didn't understand it completely in the sense of what can you do. But I think Australia at the moment is a good example of a country sort of taken the ball in its own hands and said, okay, this is our offensive interest in becoming into linking more and more with different regions. And I think that's a great example at the moment.
Well, I think it's obviously a very sort of crucial and central question. Do the numerous amounts of bilateral trade agreements, does it undermine the WTO, or sort of put leverage on the WTO to receive some kind of results? I think you could put it either way. I think it's a fact of life that we have these numerous bilateral trade agreements going on, or negotiations going on around the world. One thing is to make sure that we don't end up, if we're not already there, but with this spaghetti bowl of trade agreements that Anke mentioned earlier, because obviously that's very, very difficult for businesses to deal with, especially when it comes to different rules of origin between the various countries. So that's a discipline that needs to be looked at, obviously. But essentially, I mean, in the end, if everybody makes free trade agreements with each other, then we'll have achieved the ultimate goal of the WTO, and that is to remove tariffs in the end. So it can work that way also.
Indeed. A different perspective. From a multinational perspective. Of course, I mean, okay, let me
first take a step back on the academic perspective and the difference between bilaterals and multilaterals. Of course, multilateral way is the ideal way. It's not happening at the moment. The reality is that you have FTAs proliferation all over the world. Multinational, I'm just bringing Samsung in as an example, we are actually benefiting from the FTAs that the Korean government did with, you know, other regions, other countries in the world, the EU, US, so on and so forth. So the point, FTAs also take quite a long time to be negotiated, but it's not the length you see in the door around. So from a multinational perspective, the two things must be balanced. And sometimes we end up having FTAs which are way more beneficial than a multilateral negotiation. Not because the multilateral negotiation itself is not beneficial, just because it's not going anywhere. And that's the big problem. But of course, the downside of all the FTA is this complexity of system you need to navigate through. The rules of origin is a perfect example. So ideally, all these FTAs, which are growing in size also amongst big regions, TPP is an example, but the TTIP negotiation between EU and US is another example, they could eventually converge towards a common point.
Just to add to that, I think preferential agreements in general are the pragmatic solution. It's the reality, it's what's happening, it's the easy way of concluding deals, but it's also more, it's also a way of going beyond the rules of the WTO and the subjects and the topics that are part of the WTO, and we can see that because, you know, free trade is way beyond tariff reductions. When you look at these new trade agreements that are being negotiated, tariffs, I think, are almost on a second level of importance with respect to NTBs or investment and so on. So it's a reality, it's there, it's very important, and it's very good. Having said that, I still think that the WTO and the multilateral trading system has a role to play that preferential agreements cannot do. And that is, for example, the sort of the peer review and the monitoring across the board, which is a very, very important role. And I think it was Peter probably who mentioned the importance of trade rules in fighting against corruption, for example. And I think this is very important, and I think that we see it every day. And the more transparent rules we have, for example, trade facilitation across the board, is something which helps us from the business perspective actually fighting this sickness of corruption, and then something like a trade facilitation agreement is by definition does make sense only by definition globally. So I still think that there are two separate topics, and the WTO goes a bit beyond the mere idea of free trade.
Okay, I think we have time for one more question, and then we're probably going to close. The lady here has a question, but she's already asked one, so I just want to make sure anybody who has not asked a question has another one. Okay. All right. Well, we'll try and take two. Okay.
My question is, as we talk about these different aspects of it, with the spaghetti bowl and so forth, is there some organization or entity, ICC or the World Trade Organization, looking at best practices or the things that are working best and the things that are not working in these agreements so that that could be used as a basis for a larger agreement?
Thank you. I'll try to make it short. I'm Lars Hjelmred, a member of the Swedish Parliament. I have one question regarding the free movement for people. You're talking about trade and business and so forth. Looking at the European example, we can see that the free movement for people within the European Union has been tremendously important for the European and the EES market. But on the contrary, we can see a development that it goes more or less in the opposite the direction now. Looking at the trade negotiation between the European Union and EU, movements are not part of the negotiations, for instance, and we can see a troublesome situation in the world where we have more of borders, border controls, etc. So it could be interesting in final remarks maybe to get some sort of reaction or remarks on that issue as well, since trade and contacts between people and so forth goes hand in hand.
on the first question, of course, it could be in a very extensive list of best practices and things that don't work. I just want to, in terms of FTAs, we already mentioned rules of origin. I just want to mention another procedural aspect that sometimes represents an issue, direct shipment. Often it happens in FTA, especially in negotiated by the EU, you have this direct shipment clause, but the reality of world trade is different. You do have direct shipment, but often you don't have direct shipment, so you have to logistically stop in several, and so you cannot benefit from the FTA. So that's probably a downside of the FTA. Then on the movement of people, from my perspective, I cannot add much more in the sense that I totally agree with you that in the EU, that's been like a landmark achievement. Ideally, you can do this at negotiation of mode 4, et cetera, but this is something that at the moment stands quite still, and I don't see the way to address it.
Well, on the free movement of people, I think if you go back 1 year, who would have thought that there would be restrictions on movement between Denmark and Sweden coming up? It's severely constrained at the moment, unfortunately. But of course, that shouldn't prevent us from discussing it in a wider context, because for our companies, it's obviously extremely important that they can take experts and send them into the field and do work for them there. And all too often that's too difficult. I mean, we were discussing Vestas and Siemens earlier on wind turbines and setting those up. Sending experts to Turkey can sometimes be difficult because they need qualifications that correspond to what is required in Turkey in order to probably measure the wind speeds, etc., in Turkey. And that's, that doesn't benefit anybody, basically.
I mean, just two words from Isaac on the first question, which I think is an excellent point. I would agree that there is a need for more transparency around the different agreements that are in place, that are being negotiated, that are planned. I don't know myself which forum is providing that at the moment. Maybe there is a role there for the World Trade Organization to sort of put that in one place and see what is in the different agreements. So I think that's a very interesting point also, because that can sort of lead to a more orientational debate about how can these agreements eventually become part of the World Trade Organization or become more integrated in the multilateral system. On the second point, on the question on mobility for skilled personnel, extremely important issue. I would add even more important for small companies. As Siemens, we are in the luxury position of being represented in more than 190 markets. So very often we have people on the ground. Not always, of course, that specific person with that specific skill set. So we, of course, we need also to bring people across the world. But if you're an SME and you're doing a project in a specific market where you have no people on the ground, you are dependent on these mobility conditions for the successful completion of your product. So I think it's an extremely important issue. I also don't see a short-term gain to be made there, but I'm very happy that you brought it onto the table, because it's definitely something we shouldn't lose sight of, and especially not if we're talking about how to make trade more accessible, trade investment more accessible for SMEs. This is a crucial point. So thanks.
Okay, well, since I'm the moderator, I have the prerogative of the last word. I just want to say thank you for sort of opening up the discussion, linking up trade and movement of people, and I guess the nexus between trade policy and immigration policy. The speaker yesterday in the Integrating Africa session from the African Union mentioned that there were attempts on this continent to go the direction opposite to that, which unfortunately is taking place in Europe, which was to facilitate mobility across African countries with an African Union visa or passport. So I think that that's a positive development that we can welcome, and that will probably benefit business among others. Thank you very much for attending this session, for your questions, and we hope you found it useful and interesting. Thank you very much.